out of the way, we can move on to BP curve, the final curve in ISLM BP model. So what BP stands for? BP is balance of payments. It registers all transactions between domestic and foreign residents. So look, balance of payments is like a balance you learned about in accounting class, but this time your unit is not a company. Your unit is an entire country. And here we have the registration of all the transactions associated with one country and the rest of the world. And look, international transactions involve different currencies. So right away, we can see that the position of the balance of payment must be associated with currency market. And yes, this is the case. Balance of payment reflects supply and demand of domestic such, we can easily deduce that if balance of payment is exactly at zero, currency so exchange rate market must be in equilibrium. So, this is the first information we're going to use. This is going to be our equilibrium condition. Now, what is balance of payments composed of? For us, to keep the model as simple as possible, we will distinguish just two accounts. First one is the current account. We already discussed this one. And the second one, capital account registers all changes in ownership of international assets. In this context, between domestic and foreign residents. Okay, so look, in our case, we will be referring to assets mainly as bonds, because this is the easiest way to explain how it works. And look, the formula describing capital account is given by W times I minus IW, where IW is simply world interest rate. So, interest rate outside our country. Okay, now we need to establish the sign of partial derivative of capital account with respect to interest rate, which will be equal to W. But let's first understand how does this might work. So look, let's consider three cases. Now, if domestic interest rate is bigger than world interest rate. Look, in this situation, domestic assets, so domestic bonds, give higher return than foreign bonds. So in this case, domestic assets are more attractive than foreign assets. But look, this is not the only thing that happens over here. Look, if our assets are more attractive than foreign assets, then foreigners will want to buy our assets, domestic assets, and people in our domestic residents will now be willing to sell foreign assets in order to buy domestic assets. So in this case, economy should observe capital inflow. So now, let's simplify this. Now, foreigners, what they want to do is to purchase our assets. So, but look, our assets are denominated in our currency. Polish bonds are denominated in Polish zloty. American bonds are denominated in dollars. So what do they need to do? They need to, foreigners need to exchange their currency for our currency. So there is higher demand for our currency. So what does it do? Higher demand, the same supply, price should go up. Appreciation. So, look, let's summarize. If our interest rate is higher than interest rate, our assets are more attractive than foreign assets. So, foreigners want to buy our assets, but our assets are denominated in our currency. So, they need to purchase our currency, and higher demand for our currency creates pressure for appreciation. Okay, now, case number two, what if interest rates in our countries are lower than interest rate in the rest of the world? Well, now, foreign assets more attractive than domestic ones. So, what will happen now? Look, now our residents would like to purchase foreign assets. So, we observe capital up. But again, foreign assets are denominated in foreign currency. So, if our residents want to purchase foreign assets, they need to purchase foreign currency first. So now look, demand for our currency goes down and demand for foreign currency goes up. And that puts pressure on depreciation of our currency. Okay, so finally, the last case is our interest rate is exactly equal to 4. in this case, both assets are equally attractive, and in this case, we will have no capital flows. Pressure on appreciation depreciation. Okay, so look, I hope at this moment you start to understand how capital account works. Basically, it registers purchases of assets from different countries. And depending on the attractiveness of this asset, we observe different capital flows. And look, this should give us the clear intuition on what should be the derivative. Differentiate capital account with respect to interest rate, we double. W, this key must be positive, because when our interest rate is higher, then we should have capital inflow. So capital account should be in plus. And of course, if foreign interest rate is higher, our capital account should be in deficit. Okay, and of course, if interest rate in our country is bigger, in surplus. Balance happens when they are equal to each other. This account, again, this derivative must be higher than zero. Okay, so now that we understand how capital account works, we can go back for a second to current account. Look, actually, current account should have very similar impact, should have very similar impact on currency market telecom. Because look, in case of current account, what this means that the demand for our currency, demand for our currency is bigger than demand for foreign currency. Why? Look, because they are purchasing more of our goods than we are purchasing of their. And look, remember what we said: when you purchase goods from other country, you first need to exchange currency. So, if exports are higher than imports, then we should see pressure on appreciation. Now, what if imports are higher than exports? Well, we should observe the opposite reaction, right? Look, now we are buying more than we sell, which means that now we need to have more of a foreign currency in order to purchase these goods. Consequently, should be pressure on the appreciation because foreign currency is appreciated. Okay, so look, again, the final case. If exports are exactly equal to imports, which means that the current account is exactly at zero, there is no pressure on either depreciation or appreciation. Okay, so look, actually, at this moment, you can see that there is some self-correcting mechanism that is a balancing trade. Look, imagine for a second that we have no capital account to, and we just have trade balance. So in fact, the payment is made out of current account. What happened here? If current account is in surplus, this means that exports are higher than imports. But this, if exports are higher than imports, this creates pressure on appreciation. Our currency is getting stronger. But this makes our exports less competitive, more competitive. So as a result, you will see that exports are going down and imports are going up. This will cause current account going for zero. And if we start with the from the opposite side, so if current account is in deficit, then we have exports lower than imports, which means that now we will have pressure on depreciation. But with depreciation, exports are becoming more competitive, so they go up. Imports are becoming less competitive, they go down. Current account again goes to zero. So as you see, into currency market, there is written in this self-correcting mechanism. But look, what we need to remember that actually balance of payment is not made just out of current account. Made out of both accounts. It's made out of current account and capital account. And look, so what do we see over here is that both of those, if the sum of both of those is in surplus, if sum of both of them is in surplus, we will have pressure on appreciation. But look, this happens in various different ways. For example, we can have very big current account surplus and very little and very small capital account deficit. So look, what is important is the net effect of the two. And the same, if balance of payment, current account plus capital account, is in deficit, we will have pressure on depreciation. And so, again, this can happen in various different ways. Okay, so finally, as we said before, if balance of payments, so current account plus capital account is at zero, we can say that currency market equilibrium. So, no pressure on appreciation or depreciation. Okay, look. At this moment, I'm sorry, need to check time. Look, at this moment, can go back to the derivation of BP curve. We know how it works. We know how account works, we know how current account works. The only thing left is to put them together. So look, we can substitute all the expression. This is all we need. So, current account is autonomous export minus MPI, marginal propensity to import, times income plus times exchange rate. And now we are times IW equals to zero. Look, we're gonna do the same thing as, and this is of course going to be the BP equation. Now, what we're gonna do is the same thing we always do. So, endogenous variables on the left, exogenous on the right. So, endogenous is income. Endogenous is interest rate. Out of the multiplication, we get W times interest rate. And endogenous is exchange rate. We've got V times E. Okay, and this equals W times IW. So W times world interest rate with minus, but we move it to the other side. So we've got plus W times IW. Okay, so this is the equation we are going to use. But now, what is the slope of BP? Well, we're going to calculate it exactly in exactly the same way as of IS and LM. We're going to use differentials. Look, again, we are drawing BP curve in income interest rate space. So all we've got to do is to differentiate this equation with respect to income and interest rate. And look, this gives us WDI equals to zero. Moving this to the other hand side, we get WDI equals negative equals MDY, dividing by both sides by W and dividing both sides by DY, get that slope of is equal to DI over DY is M over W. They're both positive, so we know that it is bigger than zero. Okay, so look, what have we learned so far? We learned that the slope of IS is negative. We learned that the slope of LM is positive, and the slope of BP is is positive as well. But look, we do not know much more except for this. And look, now we introduce hidden assumption that that BP is steeper than LM. Why is it like that? Well, because it will make our calculations easier, and we will make the model more complicated in the future once we learn how to deal with general functions that will create actually way simpler derivatives than the ones we need to calculate today. But, look, collecting what we know, let's put it here, we've got that IS is downward sloping, LM is upward sloping, and BP is also upward sloping, but we will be assuming that it is that LM is steeper than BP. In the future, we will relax this assumption and we will consider all possible cases. Okay, so let's just summarize what all that we got, and let's collect let's collect all the equations. So look, first got IS equation, and we said that it looks like this. 1 minus B times 1 minus T plus M times Y plus E I minus V E equals to A plus D plus G 0 plus X 0. Then LM is given by K times what times I equals to M0. And finally, now that we have B, B, we know that it is equal to negative MY plus WI plus VE equal to X0 plus W times IW. And look, this system of three simultaneous equations constitute the complete IS-LM-BP model. Now, the details of it we're going to discuss in the next part. Thank you for your attention.